and the title I gave it was Discerning the Kingdoms, plural, the Kingdoms Among Us. Jane Hammond wrote a book called Discernment, and we've been studying it in the men's study, and I had read it even before that. It's one of the best books I've seen on it, and that's just never going to go away as a really important thing for all of us, is to have a high level of discernment, right? It's interacting with the Holy Spirit all day, every day. It's asking the Lord for revelation on the Word of God. It's not getting religious and falling into a routine where we lose the spark of His life on our lives. And Luke 8:10 says that to you has been given the knowledge of the mysteries of the kingdom of God. That's quite a job description that we have as Christians, don't you think? So could you lift your hands? Lord, we just thank you as we break open the bread of the Word of God, that it will transform us, that it will transform us, like Daniel said many times last weekend, from the inside out, that we won't be bound by religious exercises, but that we will flow in a fluency with the kingdom of heaven in the earth, that let your kingdom come now here on earth as it is in heaven, that we might operate as your ambassadors and be equipped to do the work that you've called us to do. Thank you, Lord. Say that. Thank you, Lord, that I have the knowledge of the mysteries of the kingdom of God in the earth, in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so there's probably more than, like usual, I over-prepare, but that's just something I do. Did anybody get a handout on the way in? Because I forgot to tell people. Okay, good. I guess they put it together. So we won't go through all of that today, but it is something I'll at least reference when we get a little bit further in. And I just wanted to show it to you. So this is Luke 8 in the Voice. It said, his disciples heard the words, but the deeper meaning eluded them. Anybody ever can relate to that? The deeper meaning eludes you. And we wonder, like, how can people keep reading the Bible over and over? It's the same book. Why would they keep reading the book over and over? Well, the Bible doesn't change, but we do. And we grow more like him. We keep growing in our discipleship to him. So we can read the same thing, but have greater insight, especially if we're asking him for greater insight. And this is a common thing with the disciples. And the reference here is that he had spoke about the parable of the sower and the seeds, and he would go on to explain it to them. I'm guessing most of you know that, but I referenced this already. The disciples said, what does this parable mean? He said, to you, it has been given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God. And if I could just stop for a minute and say, we're not talking about after you die and go to heaven. We're talking about the mysteries of the kingdom of God in the earth. And that's a common theme in the New Testament that people have gotten confused over time. They think it only refers to after this life is over. Well, it does refer to that, but it also refers, as Jesus said, let your kingdom come, your will be done here on earth now as it is in heaven. You believe that? Hopefully before, if you don't, before you leave, you will. But to the rest, it's given in parables. And then he quotes Isaiah chapter 6, verse 9, which is quoted often in the New Testament by Jesus and others, seeing that they may not see and hearing that they may not understand. And that could be confusing. I had somebody say it to me last week in a Bible study. They're not members of our church here. They're relatively new Christians. They say, why does he make it so hard? Why does he have to talk in these riddles and these parables? I said, because the hungry people are satisfied. Not the ones that just want a decaf version of Christianity. You're either in, you know, how long does it take the average person to be a Navy SEAL? The average person will never be a Navy SEAL. So let's think about this. If we're going to be in Christ, we got to let everything else go. It's not a partial transaction here. No, we grow into it. We're a new creation when we're born again, but we're on the milk. And how many want to get off the milk and onto the meat? Personal diets aside. So this is the book I mentioned. And I want to give you a little test for your discernment. Say, I'm ready. See, that was so manipulative. So we're going to watch a little video here. And there's two teams. Some have white shirts. Some have black shirts. If you've already seen it, then just please be quiet. Because we don't want to mess it up for people. And the goal is going to be, you have to really focus hard. There's white shirts and black shirts. You have to count how many times the white shirts pass the ball between themselves by the end of the video. And it's a very short video, so it won't take long, but you have to focus. So go ahead, Ray. Anybody got a count? 14 over here. Anybody on 13? 12? 12? 15? 3? It's 14. How many of you saw the gorilla? What? You didn't see the gorilla? Well, that's why we're talking about discernment today. Show it again, Ray. What? Gorilla? Dun, dun, dun. See what happens, right? We get so focused on one thing that things are happening around us. This is exactly what the devil wants to have happen. He wants us to be so distracted by focusing only on one thing that we miss the bigger picture. That's the only reason I'm showing it to you, because this happens to all of us all the time, is that we miss the day of our visitation. If we want to use biblical language, we miss the day of our visitation. So I had already talked about this one, right? Another plan of the enemy, but this song came out in 1970. So here we are all these years later. What is that, 52 years later, about to be 53, and it's Ball of Confusion. That's what the world is today? Well, let me tell you, if it was that in 1970, what is it now? The people, if they ever came back in a time capsule and saw what we were teaching our kids in school, that was illegal in 1970, what's being now paid for by our taxes. If we don't get upset about this, something's really wrong with us. As Christians, we have to take a stand. I'm sorry. We got to take a stand for righteousness, because if we don't say it, nobody else is going to say it. And I'm saying it. It's wrong what's happening to our children in America. It's wrong. The idea that they can be exposed to sexual, specific and explicit sexual content at 5 years old, that's a crime that's been passed as legal. So if you disagree, I'm sorry, but it's a free country, at least for now. And I'm trying to help you understand that Christianity is not a passive endeavor. It's active. You have a mission. Jesus said, as the Father has sent me, so I am sending you to church. Yes, to get equipped. That's what we're here for, to get equipped. But then to operate as a kingdom ambassador all the rest of your life. Whenever you're not here, if you're on vacation, that doesn't mean you're going to backslide. We're here as an equipping center to help you, and then to help call out what God sees, what the Lord is showing us in your life. And often it's to cancel lies that have been spoken over you, that through the prophetic gift we can see things that the Lord has in you that you don't believe about yourself. And that root gets pulled up in deliverance ministry and prayer ministry, and then the real you comes out. And boy, has the world been waiting to see the real you for a long time. So I'm going to just compare the Ball of Confusion to the Tower of Babel for a minute, because it ties in with what it says on the top of your handout on the page that has that like Excel spreadsheet going. You see, it says the stages of the transitional gospel. That's my phrase. I don't have a book written on it or anything yet, but it's just the way the Lord has shown it to me. And I want to tie it into the Tower of Babel, because if you remember, the people in the book of Genesis were marching together and building this big tower, and the Lord didn't like it because they were getting all proud of their own operation. So what did he do? He confused their language. Is that like today? Do we have a bunch of confusing language going on? You could watch the same story on two different channels and get a completely different story. And that's very difficult to know how to sort this out. Because listen, if we're honest, most of the people in America have a hard enough time just paying their mortgage and taking care of their kids and doing all their regular obligations that to have this really fine-tuned opinion about what's happening on these really complex social issues. So the church has always been that place that we can come where the rock is. And look, if you think that churches shouldn't be involved in running for school board councils or something like that, well, why not? Why not? Because if we want to be an active part of this community, why wouldn't we want to have a say? The fact that we didn't ever promote that means that they can pass whatever they want. And they tried bringing, there's plenty of videos online. Some of the moms came and and brought books to the meeting where the school board was meeting and read out from the books that were in the library that the kids had access to, and they told her she had to stop because it was pornographic. She said, that's my point. You're letting my five-year-old have access to this. No, can't do that. Not here. It was always 18 years old, and then you make up your own decision. We don't let a five-year-old go to battle, do we? Join the Air Force? Get a driver's license? Well, your sexual behavior has to come through the lens of a mature person, not a five-year-old. Sorry, I don't mean to rant here, but ball of confusion. Never would have believed that this would be something we'd even be talking about. So what does it say? This research paper said basically that Acts chapter 2, when the Holy Spirit falls, is a reversal of the Tower of Babel. So God confused the language, but then he reset. That's what we did today. We hit the button, reset, and he said, okay, I'm going to show you something. We observe there's a significant evidence that Pentecost continues, so ongoing, the curse of Babel. That's good news. Acts 2 reverses the breakdown of Genesis 11, Babel, and becomes the theological underpinning of our culture, right now, multilingual cultures. The key lies right here. Look around you. This is a local church, okay? The key lies right around you. We're not all the same. I'm Caucasian. Somebody else is African American. Someone else is Asian. We have a whole spectrum, which is the way it should be. And if it's not, it's not because it's not God's will. It's because something happens in the translation. Help me, Lord. The key lies in patiently grown churches that are heterogeneous, that can all see each other as one race, the human race. That's what we're shooting for. That's our goal. And that happens at the local level. We live lives together. Acts 2:6, I'll just take a couple of highlights out of this chapter. The multitude came together and were confused. They were all there from foreign cities coming to Jerusalem to celebrate the Feast of Pentecost. And this multitude was outside. They were confused because everyone heard the disciples, the people in the upper room, speaking not some random language, their language. Never had been taught their language, right down to the dialect of the different villages that they came from. And they had a southern accent. I'm just throwing that out there, not really. But they had enough of an accent that you could tell the guys from Galilee, because it would be like somebody from Bayonne who has a heavy accent. Just kidding. I got somebody on the front. He does not have one. But you know how it is. If you live around here, you could tell where people are from, the Bronx or Long Island. I don't know. I don't want to make fun of it. Hey, don't make fun of those people. Look, are not all these who speak Galileans? Like, they have an accent, but they're speaking. How is it that we hear, each in our own language in which we were born, we hear them speaking in our own tongues the wonderful works of God? So they were all amazed and perplexed, saying to each other, one another, whatever could this mean? Could you say that? Whatever could this mean? Well, that's what I'm here to talk about in whatever time I have left. So let's just go back, because it was the same thing the disciples were saying when Jesus gave them the parable of the seeds. They came, and the deeper meaning eluded them. And my prayer today is that you will press in for the deeper meaning of things that are going on in your life, and that you won't just shortchange your decisions up at the surface because you think you have a good idea. You want to make sure it's a God idea before you make a decision. It's much harder to reverse a bad decision than to just wait and know that the Lord is telling you what to do the first time. Somebody should say amen. And then there it is. What does the parable mean? To you, it has been given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God. What a gift! His name is Holy Spirit, but it's also the Word of God. We have to have the Word and the Spirit, those who are worshiping in spirit and in truth. That's what he's looking for in John chapter 4. And then I already said it quotes Isaiah. So we'll move forward. Now, this is Paul, who is kind of a hero to me. I'm sure a lot of people feel that way. Because other than Jesus, he probably had more to do with the advancement of the gospel than any one other person. If you read the book of Acts, you know, certainly a lot of the things that you see on the sheet I gave you, his name is on there with people, Paul and Barnabas, Paul and Silas, Paul by himself. He's all over the place. He's the Energizer Bunny. but he's suffering a lot of persecution and punishment, and he took a long gap between the time he saw the Lord on the road to Damascus. I have road to Emmaus in my head too. On the road to Damascus, and I don't remember how many years, but it's a long period of time where he just went and pondered everything that he had been shown. He had this brilliant mind, studied under Gamaliel, the best of the teachers, and yet God allowed this transition to happen inside his heart that he could take all the good from what he had from the Old Testament and talk to us about the new covenant. Aren't you grateful for that? And if that wasn't enough, he still kept his job as a tent maker when he didn't have to. And that, like, I wonder what that's about. Well, maybe he liked being with the lost because we're supposed to love what God loves. And he loves the lost and doesn't want one person to perish. And maybe if you keep telling the story over and over again to unbelievers, you get better at telling the story. The more we witness, the more of a conviction we have about the truth. And that's part of this translation thing I want to talk to you about today, because we can have all the knowledge in our mind and the Holy Spirit working for us, but he's asking us to be ambassadors, which is to speak to other people. And that's complicated, right? Because I look on the back row, and I know we've got Bronx in the house in the back row, and I know we got Brooklyn in the house on the back row. And I think, well, I know what it's like. I've been there. No, you haven't. Not the way they have. They live there. Right? So if I'm going to come across like Joe Know-It-All, they're not going to respect me because I haven't taken the time to build a relationship with them, right? Holy Spirit is so good at this. He's so good at it. If we just ask him, he'll show us. And he says this. Paul's a very humble man. He had the fear of the Lord, and he didn't want to puff up in his own pride. He said, I didn't pose as an expert with all the answers. Have you ever met a Christian who posed as the expert with all the answers? Let's be honest. Even if they're in the room today, just don't point them out. You don't want to know all the answers. Nobody knows all the answers, right? You're going to be the first person when you get through the gates of heaven, the confetti's going to fall. Peter Roselle, the first person who knew every point of doctrine. It's laughable. Stop. No. It's unsearchable how many riches there are, but we keep pressing in to try, right? I didn't pose as an expert. I didn't pretend to explain the mystery of God with eloquent speech and human wisdom. I claim to know nothing with certainty other than the reality that Jesus is the anointed one, the liberating king. Who's happy about that? Who was crucified on our behalf. The sermons I preached were not delivered with the kind of persuasive elegance some have come to expect, but they were effective because I watched a YouTube video on leadership. I went to an Ivy League college. See what happens? We get so focused, like that gorilla walked right through the middle of the scene, and some of us didn't see it because we were so focused on one thing, we couldn't pull back and see the bigger picture. And all of our own Bible knowledge is certainly helping us to avoid sin, but we're also supposed to be change agents in the community. And let me tell you, this is the best time of year to love up on people, because a lot of things get stirred up at this time, right? We just already had Thanksgiving. Now we're 2 weeks away from Christmas. And you're going to run across people who are more open to talking about sensitive things than they would be at other times in the year. As a general statement, I mean, it could always be a good time, but there's something about this atmosphere and 2.5+, really almost 3 years of COVID, after effects, children having learning disabilities, things that just get really hard to grasp how that could have happened, but they did happen, and we could be a little bit numb to how we are coping or not coping about that. So you are the Christian in the other person's life who's there as this fountain of light, glow-in-the-dark Christian. Yeah, that's in the Message Bible. No, the reason my sermons were effective is because I relied on God's Spirit to demonstrate God's power. Well, how could it be that simple? Well, it's not simple. It's easy to say. It's much harder to stay yielded to the Spirit's rule in your life, isn't it, church? Let's be honest. If this were not so, your faith would be based on human wisdom. We don't want that. We don't want our faith based on human wisdom. We couldn't get there through that channel. It's got to be based on the power of God. None of us have a high enough IQ to be equal with God. So what this part of the handout I gave you, some of you have been here a while, you've heard me talk about this. This man named James Engle was a professor at Fuller Theological Seminary when Peter Wagner and John Wimber, two people that had a big influence on our lives. They were teachers there, and he wrote a book called What's Gone Wrong with the Harvest? And what his conclusion was, I'll save you the time, but it's still a good book to read, even though it was written in the 70s. It hasn't changed. What's gone wrong with the harvest is we turned it into a formula. And we took a class. And look, there's nothing wrong with taking a class on the Roman road and how to lead people to the Lord. And all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That's very important to do. But we get like the gorilla. We miss him because it's so rote and so mechanical. We forget we're talking to a human being who's got emotions and got feelings. And God will show us those emotions and their feelings if we ask him. And if we're not so much in a hurry to get another notch in our gun, you know, when we're witnessing, oh, three people said the prayer, that's all great. Please, believe me, I'm not saying don't do that. But I want to add a little bit of a robust view of it that you're witnessing to them whether you know it or not, just by the way you live your life. So the brilliance of this chart, for me at least, is it helped me see that there's eight, he calls eight different categories of where a person could be on this spectrum. That number eight at the top, there's an awareness that there is a supreme being, but that could be New Age, that could be any one of a number of other people who say, well, there's probably something up there, but I don't know what it is, and I don't have a name for it. And Paul addresses that, doesn't he, in the book of Acts. I can tell you the name of your unknown God. Pretty good. And then all the way down, an initial awareness of the gospel, awareness of the fundamentals. And then it says, grasping the implications of the gospel. And if you remember that time when somebody was witnessing to you, and if the penny dropped, is what they would say, the English would say, oh, if I say yes to Jesus, that means I have to say a lot of no to my bad habits. I'm not sure I want to do that. And look, you better wrestle with the consequences, because you can't really make the right choice without that. And then all the way down. So his point, Mr. Engel's point, was where is this person on the scale that you're talking to and you're witnessing to? Maybe you go to a wedding and you get seated next to somebody that you've never met before. What would be the right way? Well, first of all, don't jump to any conclusions. How fast? I'll show you 10 videos about how wrong it is to jump to conclusions. We think we can label the package. We can't. It's a human being. They're made in the image of God. They might have some baggage. Does anybody here not have any baggage? Emotional baggage? Of course we do. For the rest of our lives, we're aspiring to be more like Jesus. Every day, he said, pick up your cross. Take something else to the cross to be more like me. So we're not, like Paul said, I'm not telling you from this position as the know-it-all guy. I just know that God loves you. And he doesn't want one person to perish. I may be just the person who plants the seed. I might be the person who waters the seed that was planted. God's going to be the one to give the increase. And this really helped me. So I hope it helps you too. And we'll expand on it. But the way the Lord showed it to me was four stages in this process, either good or bad. Okay, so when I say kingdoms, right, that was the title today, Discerning the Kingdoms. I could have said discerning the kingdom and you would have known it was the kingdom of God. But there's more than one kingdom, right? There's the kingdom of light and the kingdom of darkness. You have called us out of darkness and into your marvelous light. You've translated us from the kingdom of darkness and into the kingdom of your son, your beloved son. I'm sure happy to be in that kingdom. But, you know, you can change lanes. You can be a Christian and you can be operating in the kingdom of darkness. Hopefully not intentionally, but if you work on Wall Street, it's really easy. You're in the mix before you know it. Boom, boy, you got to realize they're not here to influence me. I'm here to influence them, but it could be a construction site. It could be a million places where two kingdoms are competing for your attention. I'm not missing the gorilla. Perceptive prayer, fluency, translation, and convergence. So in the third row there, we have Chin and Uni Kim. And they helped us arrange a trip to Korea that we're going to be doing in March. So I'm going to be speaking at the Wagner Leadership Institute, and so is Tricia, in Korea. And I have to have a translator. And that's not an easy job. And everybody told me, get to know her. In this case, they know who it is. And try to ask her as many questions as possible so that you can use analogies that are pertinent to those people. When I didn't do this, when I was in China, I happened to be teaching, and Peter Wagner was in the back giving me my grade. And I said, you know how it is when you have two children, how one could be so different than the other? I mean, I was just trying to have a conversation. And he said, they have a one-child program here in China. You can't say that. I'm like, oh, so sorry, so sorry. But God forgave me. Did I forgive myself? Yes. Because we don't do it intentionally. We just forget. We can so easily take things for granted. So in this example, let's just say what that first one is this discernment, this comprehension that you have. You recognize something going on. I've been in many meetings where I walk into a boardroom and the people were there before I got there, and you can feel tension in the air. And when you walk in, they stop talking, and it's not about you, hopefully. It's about something they were doing, but they don't want to let you know. Well, should you just ignore that? No, you shouldn't just ignore that. You should recognize whatever you're going to say might help break that tension or not, right? You have to make that decision. That's why there's this constant bandwidth between you and heaven and asking the Lord, how should I handle this? And I can almost tell you 100% of the time, jumping to conclusions is a really bad idea. Pause for a split second, even if you have to. Don't get set up by the enemy, because he pokes at you to get you to respond in anger. Ease of expression is fluency. And I could just use a lot of different examples. People that were playing up here today, there's a fluency in the way they play their instrument. There's a part of it where you don't have to think much about it because it comes. It's been so trained in you. 10,000 hours is the way Malcolm Gladwell said it in the book Outliers. You become an expert after you spend enough time doing things. And there's a fluency where you don't have to think about it, right? And when you call somebody cool, it means they just do this without trying too hard, because you can't try to be cool. You just blew it right there. If you're trying, you're not cool. I'll leave that one alone. Translation. All right. So not only do I want to have the perceptive prayer and I want to ask him for the fluency to know how to speak to this person, what's the best way to say it? And look, I'm telling you, any this could be when you go to the store and the girl or the guy is checking out your food. Why wouldn't he care about that person? He does. He cares about them. When we did the food drive at the ShopRite, people are walking by us, and some didn't want to make any eye contact with us. They think we're some kind of wacky cult. You know, we're collecting food for people for Thanksgiving. Other people are walking out and saying, oh, thank you so much for doing this. We're like, thank us? You're the one giving us the food. No, but thank you that you were here, and you made it easy for us to do it. And we got into great conversations with those people, because what's the reason? You're here for a reason, to reflect Christ to people. And that's why I have to discern between these two kingdoms. So a translation interprets it. So let's say you're with somebody and it just happens to come up that they were a football player or that they were in a band and they have all the tattoos. And like for me, I would be able to relate to both of those people because I lived in that world. And they like to know that you're not condemning them because they're in that world right now. And Christians are not known for that. We're known for being judgmental. But Jesus wasn't known for being judgmental, so what happened? We lost something in the translation. Doesn't mean you don't have to speak the truth. You do, could offend people. You do it in love, but you stay true to the compass. All right, I'm preaching. And then the convergence, boy, I'll tell you what, when it happens, it's amazing. When it happens and all these parts pull together and you get behind the armor of that person's heart, and they know that God is real, and they say yes to the Lord. Happened Friday night, right? This weekend, somebody came up and just started telling me how much the Lord has done in his life recently, and I had a chance to pray with him. Isn't that awesome? It was a Christmas play, but does it matter? Doesn't matter where we are. It could be any time. I just have to recognize and discern the kingdoms. And what do I do to help this person see the value of living their lives in God's kingdom, not the kingdom of the world? How are we doing? So there's that graph, is that my eyes are open, but I can miss the gorilla. And my eyes are open to the Lord. So think about if you have two ears and you're talking to somebody, one ear is tuned up to the Lord, and one ear is tuned to the person that you're listening to, and you're the conduit, and you're saying, okay, Lord, how do I hold the reins? How do I try to drive this conversation? It's not to manipulate them, okay, because you could have been trained as a salesperson, and they'll give you all kinds of psychology on how to close a deal that is not ethical, okay? Been there, Greg. Yeah, it's really rough because who do they reward? They reward the people with the most sales. So what are the people that don't know the Lord? They'll change their ethics real quickly because they can get a bigger car or whatever else. We've got a different boss. We're answering to the Lord. We're accountable to a higher power. And if you were not made to be in sales, get a different job. You'll be miserable. And if you were made to be in sales, you won't have to try too hard because, boom, you're in your zone. You're in convergence. There's one right at the back door, Rich Fetch. Great salesman. It's a compliment, brother, compliment. It's a junction. I love that word, junction. Isn't that cool? We come together with all these different pieces, and it also comes together right in that moment that you're talking. And that's when you sense the presence of God touching somebody's heart, and you could just get out of the way at that point because it's not about you. You were just a conduit that let that happen. So let's think of a couple of examples. This one is, I would say, failing to discern the dark kingdom. And if you've been here, you know I've used this verse often because it shows kind of an algorithm of how sin works. And in today's world, with so many inputs coming from so many different channels and all the different social media things, and you could say, well, you have a big social media. Yeah, because we're trying to put the truth out on that platform so people have a chance to hear it. So he says this about all of us, everybody in the room and those that are watching, we all are tempted when we are drawn away from what? From God, from the Word, from the Holy Spirit, from prayer, from living our lives being centered on God. We're drawn away and we get enticed. And part of, on the negative side, the fluency of the devil to lie is a very high level, isn't it? He is a really bad boss, but a good liar. And if you're working for the devil, your paycheck is going to bounce because he's a liar. We're tempted and drawn away by our own desires and enticed by the fluency of the offer. And then the translation is, it turns into an action. And when the desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it's full grown, brings forth death. See the stages? If they thought it was going to be death at the beginning, they wouldn't have been drawn away. But this is why you have to know the truth, like Trisha was saying, why you should be praying, why you have to know the Word, why you have to keep speaking the Word, not like a robot, but like a dad who loves you and has given you everything you need. That's what Peter said. Everything we need has been given to us. We can be partakers of the divine nature of God by living in communion with Him and, come on, with each other. How important is this part? Say very. Somebody didn't know that. It was very important. Now let's look at a different one. Luke 24, this is discerning God's kingdom when it was right among them, but they didn't see it right away, did they? This is the road to Emmaus. It says, Jesus himself drew near. I believe it's a husband and a wife, not two men, husband and a wife. I can go into that another time. But they were disciples of the Lord, and they were going back to their home. He drew near them and went and met them, but their eyes were restrained so that they did not know him. And this is back to that verse in Isaiah. Like, why would God do this? Because blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. They shall be rewarded. God says in Hebrews chapter 11 that you get a great reward. The diligent seeker gets a great reward. He rewards us when we're seeking after him. So they were discouraged, right? But there was fluency in the moment. In verse 27, Jesus speaks about at the beginning, at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all scriptures the things concerning himself. And later, they say, wasn't our heart burning inside of us as he was talking to us? Remember this? Has that ever happened to you? Yeah, it happens sometimes when you're at a meeting and somebody's speaking and it just so targets your heart. And it's like, oh, I want more of what that person's saying. Their hearts were burning, but they couldn't identify it yet. Then the translation is, abide with us. They invite him because they know there's something. Even though they don't know it's Jesus, they know there's something. And the irony is that the wife, it's the wife of Cleopas, she was at the cross. She saw Jesus die at the cross. She was with John, the apostle John, at the cross. So if anybody would have recognized him, it would have been her. But she's so focused on the fact that he died. Here he is, the risen Christ, but she can't see him yet. See what happens to us? We get blinded. We get our focus on one thing and we can miss it. And I'm not blaming her. I'm just saying that's what could happen to all of us. The convergence is, it came to pass as he sat at the table with them that he took bread, blessed it, and broke it and gave it to them. Ha! Then, see it? Then their eyes were opened and they knew him. This is a reversal of Adam and Eve sinning. When Eve ate the fruit, then her eyes were opened. Now it's Jesus coming and making it right and saying, no, the kingdom of God is available to you right now here in this earth. You don't have to wait till you die and go to heaven and get your harp and sit on a cloud. No, you're going to be actively serving the Lord for eternity, ruling and reigning with Christ. Huh, that's another book coming up in the men's ministry. And then he vanished from their sight because he was about his father's business. I'm going to go a little faster just because I see the time. I want to talk about Paul because that's where I started and that's where I'll finish. Excuse me one second. You can see many times in Scripture where he gets very emotional and he gets angry. And you know, so God is not saying that you don't have emotions. It's that he who rules over his spirit is like a city that's protected. But he who doesn't rule over his spirit, this is in Proverbs, is like a city with the walls broken down, right? So, yeah, sure, you want to have a hot temper, go ahead. But Jesus was angry and never sinned. Not likely that Peter's going to be angry and never sinned. Fair enough, right? So, yes, it's not a sin to be angry, but you can sin pretty easily in your anger. And Paul learned this the hard way, which is, I think, why he's so humble. And I think something about his conversion made him want to be with the lost. Of course he wanted to be with the Christians. He was starting churches everywhere he went. But he loved being with the lost as well, because when it says that he went to the hall of Tyrannus and speak, it was his lunch break. He would go and he was still dressed in his clothes from working and making tents in the morning. And they said, you know what, there's a bunch of sick people that can't make it here. Can we have your robe? It's like a canvas covering that he had where he would keep all his tools. And he had a bandana around his head, which is called the handkerchief, but it was from his work. So even the sweat of his brow was used by God to touch somebody. Because they said, let us just have that and we'll go and we'll lay it on these sick people. And those people got healed. Why? Because he wasn't avoiding them. He was going to them. And they were coming to him because he was reflecting the character of God. And let me tell you, you start seeing this happen, you're not going to want to live any other way. You start seeing people's lives being changed, and you're never going to want to go back to just passive, I hope he comes back. I can't wait till he comes back. Get me out of here, Jesus. I want my mansion. Let's be careful. So Paul took off. Shook off the creature. You remember this. They shipwrecked. They're on the island of Malta. The Roman centurion Paul had found favor with him to the point where even though they should have killed all the prisoners, it says very specifically that the Roman centurion, not wanting Paul to die, let them live. That's favor. See, you have that. You have it on your life as a Christian. You find favor with man and with God. And the more obedient you are to the word, and the more this becomes fluent, and you're able to translate things to people, you'll get that convergence. It's exactly what happened to Paul. He came out one day on the boat, and he said, listen, I got a message directly from heaven. An angel appeared to me and said, we're not going to die. We're going to lose everything, but not one person here is going to die. And you're like, well, you know, he's hallucinating. It was exactly true. And people that, even if they're not Christian, just watch the movie Hacksaw Ridge, right? The guy that was the Christian completely turned the whole thing around. Not by witnessing through sermons, they watched how he lived his life. And the general gets on the phone near the end of the movie and says, how come you guys haven't started taking the hill? They're like, we're waiting for this guy to pray. You remember the scene? What do you mean you're waiting for who to pray? I'm the general. You got to follow the army. He's like, nope. We trust him more than you. Once he says go, we're going. And they waited, and he got the green light, and then they went. So who's really in charge? The person with the authority and the spirit will always outrank the general in the army who's not hearing from God. That's all of us. So this is later. He shakes off the creature in the fire, suffered no harm, and the people that were there were expecting that he would swell up or suddenly fall down dead. But after they had looked for a long time and saw no harm to come to him, they changed their minds and said he was a god. So one minute they think he's deserving death. The next minute they're starting to sacrifice to him. Huh, does that sound like our culture? Kim Kardashian. whatever. I don't have anything against her. Did you know she passed the law, the bar association? She's an attorney by training. You might think she's some, I don't know, I don't want to use a derogatory term, but there's a lot of substance to that lady, and she knows how to make money. So I'm not putting her down. I'm just saying, if she was a Christian, how many more people could she influence? Somebody could still reach her, and she could get saved, right? But, like, they go from being a nobody that you didn't know about, and then, boom, everybody is worshiping these people because of their fame, but not because of the content of their character. And that's never going to change. That beautiful line that Dr. King said, I pray for the day that people will be judged by the content of their character, not the color of their skin or how much money they make or kind of car they drive. He didn't say that, but I think we could legitimately say that, right? We all judge people wrongly. And Jesus said, no, you got to love them the way, if it were you, how would you want to be treated if you were them? Not you. That's why we need these steps that I'm talking about. You've got to perceive it and discern it. You've got to have a fluency that you develop that you're going to understand it. Then you translate it into something that they can understand, which is what the parables are. They're just translating the everyday life into a spiritual principle, and then the convergence comes, and the woman at the well says, he told me everything I've ever done. That's pretty cool. And what, about half hour? Well, he's God. He could do whatever he wants. You guys okay? I'll go a little faster. He goes to Rome, my relatives, and he gets some basavazul. And Rome was the final destination. That's what the angel said. You're going to appear before Caesar. Wow, why? You ever wonder about that? What was the importance of having to go there? Well, we would say you want to be on site with insight. By being there, Paul was in the very capital of the whole empire, and he was bringing the Spirit of God right before Caesar. Now, you might say it didn't end well, but he had 2 years living there with freedom for people to come and go while he was there. And he was witnessing all along the way, right? So he was like, I don't count my life to be anything. If he takes me, great. If not, I'm going to keep doing what he told me to do. And they say to him, look, we haven't really heard much about this sect, but everything that we've heard about it, the Christians, is spoken against everywhere. And I'm just going to wind it down now. So when they had appointed him a day, the Jews came to him at his lodging and they said, he solemnly testifies of what? Can you read it? Of what? Okay, it's not the gospel of salvation. It's the gospel of the kingdom. He's telling them what we've been talking about here today. Hey, guys, open your eyes. There's two different kingdoms. One's dark, one's light. Make sure you stay on the light because the dark will pull you down and kill you in a minute. They want to steal, kill, and destroy. Persuading them concerning Jesus from both the law of Moses and the prophets from morning till evening. And some of them were persuaded by the things which was spoken, and some disobeyed. So when they did not agree with themselves, they departed. And Paul had said one word. Now, he didn't tell us what the word is, but Luke is really good. He keeps us wondering. What was the one word that made them just get up and leave the table and say, no, I can't do this? The Holy Spirit spoke rightly through Isaiah the prophet and our fathers. Remember this verse? This is Luke 8. Said the same thing. Oops, sorry. Isaiah 6:9. Go to this people and say, hearing you will hear and shall not understand. Seeing you will see and not perceive. For their, come on, heart, not their minds, but the hearts of this people have grown. Nobody here is dull. In Jesus' name. You are all alert. You are watchmen on the wall. You have a spark of the Holy Spirit inside of you that says, I'm not going to be average. I'm not going to be regular. I'm going to be a Navy SEAL for Christ. Right? There's no average person that's a Navy SEAL. I'm willing to pay the price because the results are amazing. The results of him living in me and operating through me are worth whatever hardship I might have to face. Somebody should say amen. Make me feel a little bit better. Their ears are hard of hearing, and their eyes have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears, and they should understand with their hearts and turn so that I should heal them. And here it comes. Here's the bombshell. Therefore, let it be known to you, Jewish people in Rome, that the salvation of God has been sent to the Gentiles, and they will hear it. Do I have any Gentiles here? Hallelujah. Let's stand. We are the ones that were grafted in. Whoa. Thank you, Lord. But look, this doesn't mean hate the Jews. It took them a little bit longer to figure it out. But the door opened because they rejected it, and now all of a sudden, these people are so offended that Paul would say that the Gentiles could come into the kingdom that they just get up and walk out of the room. Selah. This is the last slide, I promise. When he had said these words, when he had said that this was going to be open to the Gentiles. Man, sometime you should just look up some of the names. The Cretans. Look up who the Cretans were. They were worse than hell's angels. They were like the barbarians that would just eat raw meat. Like, you know, they could get saved? What? The rules have just gone to, there's no rules? Well, it's the heart. Man looks at the outside, but God says, now I look at the heart, and anybody can be saved. Aren't you glad? Because I didn't think I could. So he said these words, and the Jews departed, and they had a great dispute among themselves, and they left arguing. So you have a choice today. I'm hoping nobody raises their hand for a ball of confusion. Tower of Babel, crazy world that we live in. We're here to make a difference. We shouldn't complain if we're not trying to do something about it. Fair enough? Let judgment begin in the house of the Lord, but then take what we know, bring it into the culture in a way that's sensitive, that we're perceptive in our prayers, that we learn their language, we have empathy towards them, and then there's this convergence. Oh, man. The convergence that happens, that's when revival happens. When there's a convergence and there's a spark and there's a fire that starts to spread. So I just finished it with this picture for me, which is like, keep both eyes open, baby. And the light bulbs are going off and the Lord is showing you what to do because you're discerning between the two kingdoms. Can you raise your hand? Let's just close in prayer. Lord, I thank you for every believer that's here today. Those that are watching online, I thank you for the power of your word. And no weapon formed against us will prosper. We will be about the Father's business. We will be people that are glow-in-the-dark people in this culture that has never been darker in my lifetime. But I don't wring my hands over that. I say there's awesome opportunities all over because we know the truth, and the truth has set us free. And as the Son has set us free, others will know the truth, and they will be set free as well. Even people watching, or somebody that might have come here today, and you're just visiting because somebody dragged you here. Just kidding. But maybe you were kind of reluctant to come. But if anything that was said today has struck a chord in your heart, that's the Lord. That's your creator. That's the person, the being, the entity that was there when you were conceived in your mother's womb. God was there when those first two cells came together. And he's been with you the whole ride. And you're like, man, it never felt like he was with me. Well, that's because the devil was winning, because there is a devil. Just like there is a God. And when you walk out of darkness, you leave the devil and you come to God. So that could be you here today. Just if that is, could you open up your heart for a minute? We're going to say a prayer. The Christians that are here have all said some kind of similar prayer to this. And we just say, Heavenly Father, I come to you in the name of your Son, Jesus. I heard good news today, but it's hard to believe because I've made so many mistakes. But by faith, I believe that you'll forgive me for those mistakes and those sins. I turn away from that lifestyle and I turn towards you, Jesus. Make your word real to me. Fill me with your Holy Spirit and adopt me into the family of God that I could cry out, Abba, Father, that I could have a seat at the table of the King. I choose today to receive Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. Not going back. I'm going to live for you for the rest of my life here and for eternity. In Jesus' name. Amen.